those women who founded it were growing into themselves. And that's really the gift that's being offered. Mm-hmm. So everyone need not be in one group or the other, but it's so wonderful to be in sync with one's own self.
I'm beyond humble to be in your company. And I don't say that just to like kind of like ingratiate myself with you. I am truly humbled. And I could do this an early birthday gift. Tomorrow's my birthday. And I'm humbled to be able to interview you because I feel like God is still giving me opportunities and I don't take this for granted. So thank you for making yourself available to me.
This is my pleasure. Thank you.
As I was just telling Randy, you are an icon and a legend for all of us. I was just speaking about, you know, how many of us see you as a mother, because for many of us, especially my generation, we knew you as Claire Huxtable. Like, you know, you better not have any big fun because, you know, she's going to get on you. How does it feel to still have that impact on beyond this generation and a new generation as well?
I think that's... That is amazing. That is amazing. And I am humbled by it. And I am most grateful to have been able to do some work that has meant so much to people that seems to traverse generations. And that is because of the work itself. I don't attribute that to myself at all. I think it's the work.
Yes. And one of the works that you're doing around with 20 Pearls, I know that you are an AKA member yourself. Tell me a little bit about this project.
Oh, this is a very significant project. This is a documentary, yes. It's a documentary that puts the history of the sorority in context with the history of our nation. You're getting parallel understandings here. And that has not been done. It's revelatory in many aspects. For me, even as a member of the sorority all these years, there were things that I just did not know concerning the legacy of the sorority. The women who established it and the women who joined subsequently. And how that intention, that very pure intention to be of service and upliftment carried itself just steadily along as the organization grew. I was just in an interview with Deborah Riley Draper, who was directing this, and her perspective was just amazing. She embodies this spirit. She embodies the same spirit, and you know that she does in the way that this is coordinated from the perspectives that's being given. She embodies the same spirit of service. She just shared that her first act of community service came as a pledgy. On a Saturday afternoon, she had to tutor some young school children. She said that was her first act of community service in her life, and it became a habit, you know, and that's just one person talking. She speaks about it so eloquently, an organization that grew from 9 members to over 300,000 in 100.
Divine nine.
That's pretty, that says something. That says a lot. And this has been going on, not with a total anonymity, you know. You've seen things in, let's say, Ebony or Jet. You've seen things in Essence. You've seen, but never have you seen it like you see it in 20 Pearls. It's astounding.
What do you credit to the longevity of the AKAs?
Oh, I think it begins with the intention with which it was founded, and that attracted like minds. You see this in the documentary. It's reiterated again and again how like minds. It was like a magnet for women who would think that way, and the service that has been provided, the activism. that is ongoing, that is never ending, that continues. I just checked my email and I got an email from a soror saying, we got to do something about these, about this voter suppression, this attempted voter suppression. You know, it's active. It's still very, very active.
One thing that always stuck with me is that Malcolm X always said the Black woman is the most disrespected woman in the entire world. And what I've always admired about the AKAs, even though I'm not one, is the fact that you guys take up arms. The world does not love us, but you embrace the world. Like you just said, you just got an email saying, hey, Sora, what are we gonna do about the voter suppression? I just feel as though I just truly love the bond and the kinship among Black women, because I feel oftentimes in the media and in the world, it seems as though people believe Black women do not love each other. And that can be not farther from the truth, in my opinion.
Oh, you know, what's even farther than that is that Black women do not love themselves. You know, so we got to be very watchful because there are, you know, how do you respect yourself? This is the most important thing. Do you respect yourself? That's the most important thing. And when I saw some scenes from Miami most recently, I said, oh, the women don't respect themselves. This cannot be. And this, you know, we were having a discussion about this. And for me, the question becomes, what were they not given? You know? What were they not given? Because there's nothing inherently wrong with anybody. It's what were you not given? And we need to pay closer attention to how our young ladies, how our young girls are being programmed.
In your ways, how do you believe they're being programmed? Do you believe it's by the culture? Do you believe it's by the absence of role models?
No, I don't think it's from an absence of role models. I think there's been a breakdown in family structure, for one, and that affects community. Yes? All right. There's certainly been that. deliberate attempts to dismantle education. Deliberate attempts. And when I look at schools being privatized, schools, whole school systems being privatized and owned by the same companies that own institutions for incarceration, I'm saying to myself, nobody sees anything amiss in that. You don't see something wrong with that? So these schools become pipelines to prison? Ooh, no. And there are people though who work very, very diligently to see to it that young people are educated in a better way, but they can't do it by themselves, you know? We really, this was always a strong point in our community. And that was that we understood we had to see, we as a community had to see to the education of our children. We couldn't leave it to someone else. You couldn't rely on somebody sitting up in a House of Congress to make a bill. You couldn't rely on somebody down at the school board to say, it's gonna go, that you couldn't do that. We understood this in the 1920s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s. We understood it. I was educated by people who taught my father. You know, my grandmother was a teacher. My mother's sisters are teachers. My father's sisters were teachers. His brother was a teacher. I mean, we understood this. So somehow there's been a distraction and we kind of loosened our hold on this understanding. So maybe we need to pick it up again.